We were looking at the discrete time channel response and discussing the worst case ISI. So again, you drive a single pulse P of t into the channel, and the time domain output that comes here, you sample, right? That's the idea. The point is to get an idea of the quality of the signal at the input of the decision slicer, right? So the amplitude of the signal there and the noise of the signal there will tell you the bit error rate. Okay. Now, if there is no intersymbol interference, each symbol will correspond to a particular amplitude level here, and Q of that signal level divided by sigma n. This will be the, this will be some noise added here, this will be the bit error rate. And when you do have intersymbol interference, depending on the interfering pattern, you have different bit error rates. You can average all over the over all of them to get the average bit error rate. Okay, so that's the rigorous way of doing it. So, if you call this response G of n, where the cursor is G of 0, precursor is G of k for k less than 0, and postcursor is G of k for k more than 0. Okay. And the worst case ISI, what is it? It is the absolute sum of g of k for k not equal to 0, right? Because if the bit pattern happens to be such that every one of the ISI elements adds up in phase, right, in the same direction, that will get subtracted from g of 0. Okay? So, that is the worst case amplitude. Okay? So, basically this is the ISI, the worst case ISI, and the worst case received amplitude is g of 0 minus summation absolute sum of g k for k not equal to 0. Okay. So, a crude way of characterizing the bit error rate is simply to look at the worst case received amplitude. A finer way is to average over all the possibilities. Is this fine? Basically, what we are trying to do is, you get the received signal. How do I look at the received signal and decide whether I need to do something, I mean whether I need equalization so that I get good bit error rate or not. So, for that I would first estimate the bit error rate here and then see. Okay. Any questions about this? Now, in general, to visualize what happens in random data transmission, you use what are called eye diagrams. Okay. Now, the input bit pattern is random, right. So, here what we get will be also some waveform which is related to the random bit pattern. Okay. So, to figure out whether we can decode the data from that properly, we use what is known as an eye diagram. And what is that? I think it is easiest if I just show some pictures. So, what is done is the following. So, I have this particular plot is drawn for a first order case. This up here, this is the input data. So, let me blow this up a little bit. I have some pattern like minus 1, 1, 1, 1 and so on. Okay. So, this gives you something of this type. Now, you can see sometimes when there is a consecutive, when there are consecutive identical digits, this is reaching all the way to the full amplitude, And when you have isolated ones and zeros, it is alternating between like small amplitudes. Clearly, now you have to sample this at every period. Basically, here the x axis is marked as T by T s. So, you have to sample it at 1, 2, 3 and so on at spacings of 1 with some offset. Now, you can see if you sample here, you are sampling a very small amplitude, you are prone to errors, whereas if you sample here, you are sampling a much larger amplitude and you are less susceptible to errors. Okay. Now, what is it that we do? I just cut it up. Now, it is a little difficult to look at this and see whether the timing and the threshold can be selected, so that you can get optimal bitter rate. Okay. So, what is done is the following. Here, I think the two colors are visible, right. So, what I have shown is the each color shows you a period of 1. Okay. So, this is 1 bit width, the red stuff is the next bit width and blue is the next bit width and so on. Okay. Then what I do is I take all these pieces and then put them on top of each other. Okay, that's what an eye diagram is, right? So I can do it for any number, integer number of periods. Typically, we use 2 for a reason I'll just describe. So now I have shown each integer periods and then I cut up everything and put it on top of each other. Now here I show the exactly the same thing for a longer sequence. I have like 200 bits here. Right, the received stuff will be like this, and here again I have marked this red and blue marking the alternate period intervals, bit intervals. So, then what I do is I take these pieces and then put them on top of each other. Here this is a 2 bit interval, right. So, what happens is I have taken these two, put them here, and then next two I have plotted them on top of that, and next two I have plotted them on top of that and so on. So, that is what the eye diagram is. Okay. Now, if you do this for rectangular data, let me mark a few periods. Something like this. You have to do this for a large number of periods. Okay. Now, I take these first two and plot it. Okay. So, that is this part, and next I take the next two intervals and plot that. That becomes like that, and that is that, and the next two that happens to be like this, and the next two it will be like that. There will also be patterns. Here we have, next we have, let us say consecutive identical digits. Then you will also have patterns like this and that and so on. Okay. So, you have to take all possible combinations. How many possible combinations are there? So, if the pulse response lasts for n bit intervals, there will be 2 to the n possible combinations, right. Because each if the pulse response lasts for n bit intervals, right, and each bit can have 2 possibilities. So, there are 2 to the n possible waveforms, okay, 2 to the n possible combinations. So, all of these will give you slightly different patterns, you can overlap everything. If you do this for ideal rectangular data, what you see is an open box like this. This is 2 bit interval. The reason to take 2 bit interval is the following, right. When you either do measurements or simulations, you do not know exactly where the bit starts. There could be some offset. This may not be exactly t equal to 0. You do not want to sit and find that. Okay. So, like for instance, if I had started from, let us say this point, my 2 bit interval would be up to that, the next one would be there and so on. Okay. So, what I would have plotted would be instead something like this, and the next one would have been like this and so on. So, if you take 2 bit interval, you will see at least 1 bit interval completely. Okay. That is the idea. So, if you take 1 bit interval, that interval may start from like halfway into this bit and go halfway into that bit. So, that is a little difficult to visualize. So, to see at least like one full box, one bit interval, you typically plot it over 2-bit intervals. You see this everywhere. I mean, this is done in measurements. If you plot it on an oscilloscope, this is exactly what it does. If you plot a random bit pattern on an oscilloscope, right, you are familiar with the trigger of the oscilloscope, right. So, you have a random bit pattern and you have the clock that generated this. There could be some phase shift between the clock and data. Okay. So, let us say you use this clock as trigger. I mean, I am assuming this is ideal clock. This is not jittering around. If you use this clock as trigger and then you feed the random waveform to the oscilloscope, what will it show? It will show some portion of the waveform depending on how you have set the time per interval, and then it will show the next portion overlapped with the same thing and the next the same thing and so on. So, if you feed random data pattern into an oscilloscope which is clocked by a periodic clock at the same frequency, what you see is the eye diagram. Okay. It is called the eye diagram because basically it looks like an eye, especially if you plot 2-bit intervals, and the opening, the amount of this open area, that tells you how good the signal is, right. In case, in the ideal case, it will be fully open, that is both in the horizontal direction and in the vertical direction. Okay. The horizontal opening will be equal to the bit interval, the vertical opening will be equal to the peak to peak amplitude. Okay. Is this fine? Now, if you do the same thing with filtered data, what happens is because of inter symbol interference, you see that. So, this, by the way, this is the clock also can be plotted as an eye diagram. Of course, if the clock is periodic, you will not see any difference because, I mean, by definition periodic means every period looks the same, you overlap it, you will get exactly the same. So, you will see something like this, that is the red stuff is the eye diagram of the clock. This blue stuff is the eye diagram of the ideal rectangular data. So, you can see fully open eye, it is open horizontally and it is open vertically. If you pass it through an RC filter, this is the stuff that you get. First of all, I told you that there will be some time shift between this and that, right. The 0 crossings of the input are at minus 1, 0 and 1, whereas the 0 crossings of the output data are somewhere here near half and minus half. Okay. Now, you can see the eye is not completely open in the horizontal direction or the vertical direction. Now, if you did want to sample this, where would you sample it? I mean, if you look at this, it is clear, you have to sample it somewhere near the peak here, right. So, that is why I have also drawn the clock such that the rising edge of this, the positive going 0 crossing of this is the ideal sampling point. Okay. At that point, you can see some opening. This opening is far from the full width or the full height, but there will be that eye opening. So, basically this eye diagram is plotted, and by looking at this eye opening, you can get an idea of what the bit error rate will be if you take this data and try to receive it by slicing it, by making decisions on it. Okay. Is this fine? So, the vertical eye opening essentially tells you how much noise you can tolerate for a given bit error rate, or for a given amount of noise what the bit error rate will be, right. So, if I choose this as the sampling point, exact 0 crossing of the clock, then the worst case amplitude is here, the highest amplitude is over there. Okay. So, the worst case amplitude kind of tells you how much the bit error rate will be. If you add a certain amount of noise, if you make decisions on it, then in some cases the input, the sampled value will be over there, right. So, that tells you how much the bit error rate is. So, the vertical eye opening tells you basically the bit error rate if the clock is at the ideal sampling position, but the clock also will not be exactly at the ideal sampling position. You know this, right. The clock will jitter around either because of systematic reasons or because of random noise and so on. So, the horizontal eye opening will tell you how much you can tolerate a horizontal movement of the clock with respect to data. Okay. So, we know that especially in digital CDRs, there is always a systematic banging around. Now, you can see if that resolution is too poor, let us say you had this phase interpolator, the multi-phase selector based architecture, if the phase resolution is very poor, what can happen is that it jumps around by a large amount. So, even if it is centered nominally, if it goes too far to the left or right, you can see the bitter red will degrade because the amplitude is reducing further. Okay? And random jitter can even take it into the take it towards the these zero crossings when you will certainly get very high bitter red. Okay? So, that is the utility of this eye diagram. The eye opening will tell you something about the quality of the eye. Okay? Now, the brute force way of finding this eye diagram is you take the channel, you send a random bit stream for like you have to do basically for a large number of bits and then do this basically plot the overlapping, I mean plot let us say 2 period intervals in an overlapped way, that gives you the eye diagram. There are like standard routines in all this many simulators, even MATLAB has a function called eye diagram and then that will plot the eye diagram. Okay, that is how I plotted this one. Now, when you specify channels and things like that, you may not want to do such like very long simulations, or at least when you specify it, you may want to have a better way of simulating that. So, that is where the other thing that we discussed earlier, that pulse response and those things come in. Okay? This is of course, related to the pulse response. You see that if the timing offset I selected is such that I was sampling here, then you can see what is this point. This is the minimum received amplitude, right? That is basically g of 0 minus summation of g k for k not equal to 0. And the highest value would be what? G of 0 plus that, right? That is the highest possible value you can get, and g of 0 itself will be somewhere in the middle. Is this okay? Now, another way of getting the same eye diagram without going through this simulation over a very large number of bits is to use what is known as statistical eye, which is very closely related to what we were discussing earlier, right? That you take the sampled pulse response and then calculate the average bitter rate from there. Okay? Any questions about the eye diagram? Is it okay? Eye diagram only relates to a particular signal. So, if the input input data has jitter, that will be reflected in the eye diagram, right? Because if the input data had jitter, for instance, now exactly how jitter comes out, that depends on the channel characteristics also. But let us say the input data had jitter, but no amplitude distortion. Let us say we had a transmitter like that, then the input eye diagram itself would look like this. Okay. Now, this you can see if it passes through the channel, the same channel, it probably makes these edges also a little bit wider. Okay. That is the spread in the horizontal direction, it increases. Okay. So, basically if you take this, let me copy this over again. So, if you look at this, this is the jitter in the received data, right? Because the zero crossing, I mean these are the nominal zero crossing points, let us say, but it is going before and after that by a substantial amount in this case. Okay, so, that is the jitter in the output data. So, even if the input data does not have jitter, because of ISI you will have jitter, okay? Because you can see the zero crossings here exactly once you start a plus 1, where it crosses 0 will depend on whether previously you had a sequence of minus 1s or just a single minus 1 and so on. Okay? So, the delay to the zero crossing will change. So, that is what causes this jitter. Okay? Now, if the input data itself was jittery, then you can I mean that exact effect you have to simulate, but it could be that it increases the spread even further. Okay, it's very likely to do that. Which variance goes on increasing? No. You are talking about the absolute jitter of a VCO, right? In a VCO, of course, in a unlocked VCO, the variance goes on increasing. So, if you look at the deviation from an ideal periodic clock, the variation goes on increasing. And if you plot the eye diagram of something like that for a sufficiently long period, where the variance has become a good fraction of a period or even more, then you will see a completely closed eye, because everything will be smeared out. Okay? Now, let us say you have a PLL which is locked to a perfect reference, that is the reference itself does not have any jitter. Then what happens is that the variance is not unbounded. In that case, it is bounded. I did not talk about that, the variance of a PLL, because either a CDR or a PLL, however it is, or maybe let me show this properly. Maybe I will do this like quantitatively in one of the classes, but the open loop VCO has a phase noise like this, which is 1 over f square everywhere, and its variance compared to an ideal clock, if you start from a synchronized state, it goes on increasing with time. Okay, so, if this was a by f square, I think this will be 4 pi times a t naught square times t, where this t is the time, it is directly proportional to time, t naught is the oscillation period, okay, and a is the constant that appears in the phase noise. Now, what does the phase noise of a locked PLL look like, or a CDR? You have calculated this, right, for the assignment. So, the phase noise of a VCO goes through the transfer function phi out by phi VCO and then gives you some other shape. What is that? It is a band pass stuff. Okay. So, assuming that the PLL or the CDR bandwidth is here, it will be like that, and if there is a 0 here, it will do that, right. This part is exactly same for the PLL and the CDR. Now, I will not show it for this exactly, it is approximately true, but let us say the closed loop phase noise was something like this. Okay? That is, it does not go to infinity as you go to lower frequencies, but it becomes a constant. Then this would, what this would do is, it would go on increasing, right? And at some point, the variance becomes flat. Okay? And this will be the absolute jitter. So, the absolute jitter in a locked PLL is constant, it is not unbounded. Okay? This makes sense, because in the long term, you have corrections from the reference, either the data in a CDR or the reference frequency in a phase locked loop. Okay? So, in the long term, it does not become unbounded. So, in that case, it is fine. Right? But that is a good point. If you have data from an unlocked VCO, the, let us say it is stable in terms of its frequency, but its phase noise will go on, I mean its phase noise is increasing as you go to lower and lower frequencies. So, the variance goes on increasing as you go to longer and longer times. So, if you go to such a long time that the variance is, let us say, equal to a period, that is possible, you will have completely smeared out eye. Okay? Is this fine? But what happens in a real system is, first of all, this absolute jitter will be still like a much smaller fraction of a period. You cannot work where this flat part becomes, let's say, half a period, then I think it just doesn't work, or even such a big fraction of a period. It has to be quite small, even this saturated value of absolute decay. On top of it, what happens is that you let's say the transmitter has a jittery clock. Okay, it's not a great thing, but it has jittery clock, and then it generates the data, and the CDR will track some of the jitter. Okay, finally, for data recovery, what matters is the jitter of the data with respect to the recovered clock. Okay, not the absolute some ideal periodic clock, because we don't have the ideal periodic clock. Okay, because let's say at the transmitter we have an open loop VCO. This is never done, but let's assume that that's the case. Then still you will recover data correctly, because if you look at it with respect to an absolutely, if you look at it with respect to an ideal periodic oscillator, the variance of that goes on increasing with time and the eye diagram will be smeared out. But what does the CDR do? The CDR also tracks the jitter, right. So, over the long term it will simply track the jitter of the VCO and then it will give you the correct data, probably. It can give you the correct data, because it can track the jitter of the VCO in the long term. Okay. Because finally, for data recovery, what matters is the jitter of the data with respect to jitter of the clock. Okay. Now, there are a number of different sources of jitter. We didn't talk in detail about it. We just said jitter and talked about only a couple of sources. One is like purely random jitter due to noise sources, and the other is some systematic jitter due to bang bang effect and so on, right. But there are other jitters also. One such jitter we have already seen right here. It is due to ISI. This jitter here, this is due to ISI. This has got nothing to do with aperiodicity of the clock, because the clock that generates this data is perfectly periodic. It is simply because of the spread in the zero crossings due to bandwidth limitation of the channel that you get this. Okay. Now, this jitter is a very high frequency jitter, okay, because this happens when these bits are varying rapidly and so on. Okay. This jitter happens, this jitter value is different for different bit patterns. So, if you have 0101, it will be different. If you have 00100, it will be different and so on. Okay. So, this varies very rapidly. This cannot be tracked by the CDR. Okay. Mostly this ISI jitter cannot be tracked by the CDR. Okay. So, again the way, another way to think about it is ISI basically lasts as long as the impulse response of the channel lasts, or the pulse response of the channel lasts, right. That is a few bit intervals, or maybe even tens of bit intervals. The CDR usually does not do anything within that period, okay, because the CDR's bandwidth is much smaller, and any action the CDR takes for correcting the phase is over hundreds of bits or something, or even longer than that. Okay. Because what was the bandwidth of the CDR? 4 megahertz, right, in the previous assignment, and the data rate was 10 gigabit, 5 gigabits per second. So, we are talking about essentially 1:1000 ratio almost. So, the CDR, roughly speaking, it corrects for things in the thousands of bits interval, not in the tens of bits interval. If you had ISI which lasted like 20 bits. So, the effect of the jitter also is from those bits alone, right. The jitter due to ISI is due to those 20 bits. Okay. So, each bit changes things only in the 20 bit interval. So, that is very rapid. So, that just cannot be tracked by the CDR. Okay. This is fine. So, the only way is to somehow keep this ISI jitter to within some limits. Okay. Typically, you would want this eye opening in the horizontal direction to be at least like half the, let's say about half the bit interval or something like that, or at least not substantially smaller than that. Now, one thing is, we will make it more precise in all these things, like in anything related to data communication, right. We have to specify everything, whether it is good or bad, with respect to some bit error rate. Okay. Because right now, again, if you do not have any random noise, like I said, although you have a lot of ISI, what will be the bit errors if you sample over here? It is 0, because if there is no random noise, this is a positive number, all these will be detected as 1s, all these will be detected as 0s. So, there is no effect at all. In fact, it could become even smaller and then it will be the same. But of course, we do not have such a situation, we have random noise and there will be bit errors. Okay. So now, so one way is just brute force simulation. We do that also many times. Actually, in MATLAB you can do this. In fact, I will show some models that you can extract. What happens is this S parameter models, right? They will be extracted over a certain frequency range. Now, to do this, you need the impulse response of the channel. So, how do you get the impulse response from frequency domain data? So, let us say some block is described in the frequency domain. How do you get the impulse response? Yeah, you have to do inverse transformation. But the point is, to do inverse transformation, you need data from 0 frequency to infinite frequency. But you always have measurement data from some lower limit to upper limit. So, you have to do some interpolation outside that. Okay. So, this is always a little bit risky and sometimes error prone also. This is one of the reasons why this spice like simulators, right, Spectre or any simulator that you use, it works very well for lumped components which have a description in the time domain. But if you have S parameter description, the frequency domain analysis like AC analysis is okay, because that is done only at specific frequencies. But to do the time domain analysis, you have to invert that frequency data and come back to time domain. Because you have it over a limited frequency range, that can be like very error prone, and sometimes you see all kinds of bizarre behavior and so on. Okay. So, here also you want to get the, you have to somehow interpolate the S parameter data and then get the impulse response. So, that is one way to do that, and I will show, I mean this is actually quite simple. There is an inbuilt MATLAB routine. What it does is, it gives you a filter with poles and zeros, which will have the same frequency response as some given data. Okay. So, you measure the response of the channel over some frequency range, and then you fit a pole zero response, so that over that frequency range it fits this very well. Okay. Now, outside it, it does something else, but this pole zero model can be simulated very easily in the time domain. So, that becomes sometimes easier and better. Okay. So, this can be simulated. Now, somebody proposed this idea that instead of doing this, I mean this also is a little bit sensitive to what bit patterns you use. Okay. So, like I said, ISI lasts n symbol intervals or n bit intervals, and you are using binary data. Okay. So, there are 2 to the n possible n bit patterns. Okay. So, you have to simulate over all of these things to get the eye diagram properly. Okay. And the n can be quite large in the sense it can be 20, 30, 50, something like that, but 2 to the 50 is quite a large number also. Okay. So, instead of that, what we try to do is, we do one simulation, that is you evaluate the pulse response, that is for n bits. Okay. I mean n bit interval basically, until it goes to 0, and from there we can get all the data also. So, what is done is the following. What did I call this yesterday? Y of t, is it? Let me just say W of t, and here I apply P of t, which is just a rectangular pulse, and this W of t, like I said, it will go through some delay depending on the delay of the channel, depending on the physical length of the channel, and then it will do something and it may take a long time to die out. So, then yesterday I said that I will take the peak of this as the sampling point, and I take other samples at 1 bit intervals away. Okay. Now, let us say there are, this gives me z of n, and this is non-zero for n. I mean, let us say that this has n non-zero values. Okay. So there are 2 to the n possibilities, right? Or 2 to the n minus 1 possibilities. So let's say n plus 1 non-zero values. That is, you have the cursor, and you have n inter-symbol interference elements, and you have 2 to the n possible ISI values. For each one, there is a bit error rate. You can calculate the BER. Okay. So for this, you have to assume a certain amount of noise. And now, let's say you shift the sampling point. Okay. I have shifted the cursor to the right. I mean, yesterday I had said that I'll take the peak, but it could be to the right or left of that also. So I shift the sampling point, and I go through the same exercise. I get some g1 of n. Okay, and this gives me a certain other BER, right? So I do this for, I mean, I have to do it with a shift of 1 period, right? I have to take basically from this point to that point, I take various points, and then for each one I calculate the BER. Okay. And so what will that look like? The BER curve. I mean, if it is at the peak, you expect the BER to be best, and then as you go down, the BER will deteriorate. Okay. So let me see. I mean, this is not exactly the statistical I. So let me do this slightly differently. It's related to this. This is all in simulation. This is for specifying I have some sigma n. Okay. And here I sample it at integer multiples of t naught plus some offset t s. Okay. And here I will get the discrete time response g of n, and remember you get a different g of n for different values of T s, right, different values of timing offset. Then the simulation stuff that I do is the following. I subtract some threshold voltage, basically I compare it with V T h, that is what I am doing, and this is the decision slicer. Okay, this just tells you the sign of this. Okay. So now, so I send a single pulse, let us say a single one. And I will get something here at the cursor that depends on many things. What does it depend on? First of all, it depends on the timing offset T s. It also depends on the threshold. Okay. So now there is a certain probability that this will be detected as minus 1. Okay. So that I calculate. So let us say I call this B naught. B naught is basically where the main sample is taken, and there is a certain probability that that will be detected as minus 1 instead of 1, and that we know how to do. Basically, I do not want to write down everything in equation form, that will lead to some complicated notation. Basically, for every value of T s, you have a different g of n and you have a cursor, right. And from this you can compute the average bitter rate, okay, because you will have g of 0 plus some pattern times g minus 1 g 1 up to some g l, okay. So, this is some bit pattern. This bit pattern can be all minus 1s, all 1s, basically every possible combination of the binary pattern, okay. So, from this you can calculate the average BER. I mean, actually not just this, from this you can calculate the possible values that you get, right, all the possible values that you get, and from this and VTH you will calculate the bit error rate, okay, because it will depend on this value minus VTH divided by sigma n q of that, that is the bit error rate. So, then what I do is vary T s from 0 to T naught, that is over the bit interval. After that everything just repeats, right, because you are again back to the same position, and vary V T h from 0 to some maximum value, okay. So, for all these combinations you calculate the bit error rate. I mean, this looks complicated in that this looks like you are again back to simulating for a large number of cases, but you are simulating the channel only for one case, okay. That is, this continuous time simulation is done only once, okay. Once you get W of T, after that the remaining stuff is simply picking values from there, okay. So, this is not the same as simulating over 2 to the 30 or 2 to the 50 bits, okay, 2 to the 20 bits and so on. Is this clear? Because once I have this waveform W of T, the rest of the stuff can be done from that waveform, okay. All I have to do is I look at the value of W of T at T equal to k T naught plus T s and vary T s. I have all the values, I mean W of T for all T. So, this is easy, and similarly all I need to do is calculate this value. This value is what I would get for different possible inter symbol interference components, right, inter symbol interference patterns, okay. And for that I calculate this bit error rate, okay, for different value of VT, values of VTH. What is it this I am really doing here? I mean, once that becomes clear, this should be obvious. What I am doing is the following, okay. So, that is easier to explain on the eye diagram. So, I am varying the sampling clock. Here the sampling clock is shown in the middle. What I am doing is I am varying the sampling clock from here to there over a bit interval, okay, at with some resolution. You can take 100 points or 50 points or whatever. And similarly, I am varying the decision threshold from here to there. I need to know what the maximum value is, but I am varying the decision threshold, and I am calculating the BER in every case. What will I get if the sampling point is here and the decision threshold is there? I will get a certain BER. If the sampling point is here and the decision threshold is there, I will get a higher BER, okay. And similarly, if I go there, it will be even higher BER and so on, okay. Is this fine? And similarly, if the sampling point is here and the decision threshold is there, I will get some BER. Because the I is becoming smaller, I expect this BER to be higher than that BER, okay. And then again as you go away from the optimal point, you will get higher and higher BERs. So, essentially what you have is a 2D map of BER. So, if I, this is the unit interval T naught, and let us say this is 0, okay, and this is the maximum signal value, and I have taken some number of points, I mean some number of sampling intervals, let us say here. You can take lot more than this, I am showing some limited number. So, I do it for all these sampling instance, and I also do it for different threshold levels. Now, for every combination here, for every point here, there will be a certain value of B r. So, I have the 2D map of the B r as I vary the sampling instant and the decision threshold. And from there, what I do is I draw contours of equal B r. That is, I say 10 to the minus 12, right. So, what happens is when the sampling instant is here, okay, maybe at this point I will get. So, let me show it more finely. When the sampling instant is here, maybe at this point I will get, sorry, at this point I will get 10 to the minus 12. When the sampling instant is there, the eye would be little more open. So, I can go here, I will get 10 to the minus 12, and when the sampling instant is over there, maybe here I get 10 to the minus 12. So, if I draw this contour of 10 to the minus 12 B r, what I get is the eye diagram, you understand. So, this is a little complicated to imagine, but first just think about the process. What you are doing is, you just imagine a communication link, and if you had to measure the eye diagram, in fact, this by the way, this is not just like just for simulations. This measurement is also used sometimes on a chip, on an IC, to see the quality of the eye. Remember, you can't take the signals out. That itself is a nightmare, because these are very high frequency signals. If you try to take them out, you will either load that node and reduce the bandwidth, or taking it out itself will need another high speed buffer outside and so on. So, that is a problem. So, you do not want to do all that. So, on the chip itself, typically you have an arrangement to vary the phase of the recovered clock. The clock and data recovery is working, and it will give you the ideal phase, but you can vary it from there by using programmable delays. And then you can also vary the decision threshold, that is, when you have the flip flop, you subtract some value before feeding it to the flip flop. So, with this you will get the bit error rate. You can send a known bit pattern, get the bit pattern, and then find the bit error rate. So, you can make the 2D map of this one. Okay. Now, here we are doing it for the sake of simulation, and I think you can see that if the eye diagram, if the measured eye diagram was actually like this. So, typically it, this is what it looks like. This is the open portion of the eye, these parts are closed. So, let us say what I am saying is, if the sampling instant is over here, maybe at this point you get 10 to the minus 12 for this threshold value. Okay. That means, that for this threshold value you will get an error that is much less than 10 to the minus 12. Now, if you go to this sampling instant, you will have to be there. If you go to this sampling instant, you have to be there. So, if you plot a contour of equal B r, that itself is an eye diagram, right. And in fact, that has in some ways more information than the eye diagram. The eye diagram just shows you the signal, but this tells you what B r you will get for, of course, a certain amount of noise. You have assumed some value of sigma n and plotted this thing. Is this okay? So, this is sometimes also specified, and later we will see like what can happen is, one thing I did not show, but it must be obvious by now, that it is possible for this opening to be 0. Okay. That is, for instance, if you go to a case where this, when it rises up, it does not go above 0 at all, right, then the eye will be completely closed. There is no point where it is actually open. Okay. And similarly, that means that in the statistical eye that we see, so in all these points the bit error rate will be very high. You will never, I mean, you will not have any place where the bit error rate is, let us say, 10 to the minus 12. Maybe the bit error rate everywhere is, let us say, higher than 10 to the minus 2 or something. So, that means that the eye is completely closed. Okay. Now, the reason for specifying this eye diagram as opposed to you are just looking at the frequency response, like I said, you can look at the frequency response and the attenuation at half the data rate, but it is very incomplete, it is only approximate. But the eye diagram is better, because the eye diagram actually tells you where to sample and how much signal you have at the sampling instant and how much room you have for the sampling instant to move. Okay. So, you can specify the eye diagram, that is better. And also what can happen is, the eye diagram can be completely closed if the channel is sufficiently bad. But then what you do is, you say that I have this prototype equalizer. With this ideal equalizer, I will get this much eye opening. So, that is also a useful specification, because then When you are designing it, you can go and try to design that equalizer. Okay? So, that is why this is used. So, that is the reason for specifying I diagram instead of only the frequency response data. Now, the third thing is this seemingly complicated method of calculating it. This was introduced so that you do not have to run long simulations of the channel to get the I diagram. Okay? This is done so that you run one simulation with a single unit pulse, let us say rectangular pulse, and from there get all the information. Is this okay? Is this clear now? Yeah. No, no. So, that is what for you calculate the average, you can calculate the worst case, then you will get a single, I mean you will get some contour, right. If you calculate the worst case BER, then you will get something that is the inside of the eye sort of. You can calculate the average BER also, right, for every possible bit pattern you can do that. So, for every value of TS, you get a certain G of n, and for G of n which has n plus 1 non-zero elements, you have 2 to the n possible patterns, and from there you can calculate the average BER. Okay? So, let me try to show you the like better picture of this, that may be easier. So, you can see the kind of channel that can be there. It is low pass, but you can see all kinds of weird behavior over there. Okay. So, you can take the inverse Fourier transform. These slides are from Professor Pawan Hanumolu's course. Okay. He gave a short course here on serial links. So, you can take this, but you will see a lot of wiggles over here. Okay. That is there. So, you get this pattern. And like I said, you have the long delay first of all, and then you could have reflections from far away. Okay. So, that is the impulse response is almost gone to 0, but then it has some non-zero stuff. So, this also contributes to ISI, but from a far away point. Okay. So, this is about how to fit the filter. So, you can fit some filter, right. So, this shows you what is happening. Let me see, where is the I? Picture of a statistical eye, which is what I okay. Sure. So, this is the sort of picture I showed you yesterday. I mean, he has shown it for both minus 1 and 1, but I showed you only one side of it. It is symmetrical anyway. So, in this case, he has taken like basically 2 interference elements. Okay. So, there are 4 possible patterns, each with a probability of 1/4, and he is calculating the average bit error rate. Similarly, I mean you could have a large number, so you will have some distribution like this, and then from there you can calculate the average bit error rate. And this is the statistical I. Okay. So, this is a 2D map. A 2D map is a little bit hard to interpret always, but you can see if you look at this 10 to the minus 12, it is this pale blue color. So, the pale blue color is over there. So, that means that if you want to be in the 10 to the minus 12 bit error rate or lower, you have this much window for any errors in your setting your threshold, setting your sampling point and so on. Okay. But it is possible for a bad channel for this to be completely closed. You may not have any pale blue part at all, that is you will not have any place where you get a 10 to the minus 12 bit error rate. So, clearly if this area becomes very small, however you calculate it, you can do brute force simulation, you can do the statistical I. Or you can do the worst case I. Worst case meaning, I mean you, these two blue line, I mean lines. Of course, after this crossing it does not make any sense. I mean there basically one is being interpreted as minus 1 and vice versa. Okay. But you can see that is really the worst case, in that it is slightly overestimating the error, right, compared to this pale blue stuff. So, but that is the worst case, that is simply g of 0 minus absolute value of the sum of absolute values of the rest of the elements. Okay. So, however you do it, if you see a sufficiently big opening, what you can do is you can simply go to the CDR. If you do not see a big enough opening, you will have to equalize it and then go to the CDR, that is the idea, right. So, the statistical I mean it is not some integral part of serial link design or something. We could have done things without this also, because you can simulate the eye diagrams anyway. But this one, although it looks a little complicated to understand, it may be quicker to do with a script, because you are not running very long simulations. Is this okay? So, please think about these things, we will look at equalization starting from tomorrow. Channel is? Yeah, yeah, definitely. Yeah, yeah. That means that you can see, basically, if I gave this map, what would you do? You want to have lowest bitter rate. So, you will choose some point here which gives you the lowest bitter rate, the decision threshold and the sampling point. But if the eye opening is very small, you cannot find such a point, or it will be very sensitive to errors. So, it basically means that if you implement this, you will get a very high bitter rate.